Hello friends, today's lecture it is kind of a general lecture on alloy designation and some processing methods which we use for making or for processing bulk materials, and that we will discuss today. Okay, so in alloy designation, first alloy which is of utmost importance and widely used is steel. Okay, and in steel there are different grades of steel are available. Okay, and these are given by designation. Okay, provided by these two agencies. Okay, so AISI is American Iron and Steel Institute, and SAE is Society of Automotive Engineers. Okay, so these two agencies are responsible for making the grades or making the designation for the grades for different materials. Okay, so in this case steel, for steel it is given. So SAE designation, if you see, there are different numbers are given here. Okay, and then XXX is written. So the first digit here actually specifies the major alloying element. Okay, so for example, if it is only plain carbon steel, only carbon is added as an alloying element, then it will be having the first digit as 1, and then there are 3 more digits remaining there. Okay, so the first digit is specify, if it is 1, that means it is going to be the carbon. Okay, main alloying element. If it is 2, then nickel will be there as a major alloying element. Okay, of course carbon will also be there, but now the main alloying element is nickel, and which actually dictates the properties. Then 3 series is nickel chromium. Okay, 4 series is molybdenum, and 5 series is plain only chromium. Okay, in 3 series it was both nickel and chromium were there. 6000 series is chromium and vanadium, 7000 is tungsten, 8000 is nickel chromium molybdenum, and 9000 is silicon manganese. Okay, this is one of the important alloy for magnetic application, as we discussed that silicon steel are one of the most important alloys for any transformer application or soft magnetic material application. Okay, so in plain carbon steel, we are not going into details of all the steels because it is a very long list, and each one has some variation in the composition and then their usage. Okay, so for example, if you take plain carbon steel, now you can see in that 4 number series another number is added here. Okay, now it is 0. So in this case it is only a plain carbon steel. In some cases you will have some other number also, so these are depending upon what kind of another chemical treatment is given. Okay, in some cases it is kind of dephosphorized or desulfurized, or it is added or removed and so on. Okay, so depending upon that, this number will keep on changing. So in plain carbon steel also, depending upon what type of treatment was given to the steel, the number will come in the second digit place. Okay, right now it is simple plain carbon steel, that is why it is 0 here, and now still the 2 numbers are left here. Okay, so if it is plain carbon steel, we are only dealing with carbon, so this last 2 digits will be responsible for telling us the composition of the alloy. Okay, so first 2 digits indicate the grade of carbon steel, what grade. Okay, and the last 2 numbers indicate the approximate middle of the carbon range. For example, in the grade designation, if it is written as 1035, okay, then it represents a carbon range of 0.32 to 0.38%. So it is a range, and if you take average of that, okay, it will come somewhere around 0.35% carbon. Okay, so that is why in the designation it is written as 1035. Okay, so this is how you will get usually the if you want to go and buy plain carbon steel in the market. Okay, this is the type of designation you have to specify. Okay, just to know, just to tell the seller that what type of material you want. Okay, so it is plain carbon steel. So now depending upon carbon percentage, it will be low carbon steel और हाई कार्बन स्टील एंड सो ऑन. ओके, सो यू विल नो दैट व्हाट टाइप ऑफ मटेरियल यू वांट फॉर ए सर्टेन एप्लीकेशन. कमिंग टू एल्यूमिनियम, अनदर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट मटेरियल यूज्ड इन लार्ज नंबर ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एप्लीकेशंस. ओके, सो दीज आर द वाइडली यूज्ड मटेरियल, दीज टू क्लास ऑफ मटेरियल्स इन काइंड ऑफ डेली प्रोडक्ट्स. सो एल्यूमिनियम इज अनदर वन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट अलॉय. ओके, एंड दे ऑल्सो हैव अ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ सीरीज डिपेंडिंग अपॉन वॉट इज द अलॉइंग एलिमेंट. ओके, इफ़ यू रिमेंबर द टेम्पर डेजिग्नेशन वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड वेन वी वर डिस्कसिंग हीट ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ एल्यूमिनियम कॉपर अलॉयज. ओके, दैट वी कैन गिव डिफरेंट सफिक्स टू स्पेसिफाई दैट वॉट इज द हीट ट्रीटमेंट वॉज गिवन टू द मटीरियल. ओके, सो दैट इज ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड. नाउ द रिमेनिंग नंबर्स विच आर देयर विल टेल यू अबाउट द कंपोजिशन ऑफ दैट अलॉय. ओके, सो द कंपोजिशन विल बी देयर एंड द टेम्पर डेजिग्नेशन विल बी देयर. सो कंबाइंड देम यू विल बी एबल टू नो दैट विच मटीरियल वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट. ओके, एंड वॉट इज द कंपोजिशन ऑफ दैट, वॉट इज द ट्रीटमेंट गिवन टू दैट पर्टिकुलर मटीरियल, और इन योर केस वॉट एवर एप्लीकेशन यू वॉन्ट दैट मटीरियल फॉर. ओके, सो फ्रॉम योर डिज़ाइन पर्पज यू केम टू नो दैट वॉट यू काइंड ऑफ स्ट्रेंथ यू वॉन्ट, वॉट काइंड ऑफ इफ पॉसिबल सम डक्टिलिटी शुड बी देयर. ओके, सो फ्रॉम दैट यू कैन गो बैक टू द दैट मटीरियल. ओके, एंड सी दैट विच मटीरियल इज एबल टू सेटिस्फाई योर कंडीशंस. ओके, एंड वॉट शुड बी द हीट ट्रीटमेंट गिवन टू दैट मटीरियल टू गेट दोज प्रॉपर्टीज. ओके, then as an engineer it is always important for us to understand that what are the cost benefit analysis has to be there. So what is the cost of that particular material and how much it is going to benefit for whatever application you want that material for. Okay, so this cost benefit analysis will always be there for any engineer because there are large number of materials, some alloying elements are expensive. Okay, so you will have to see whether you need that kind of compositions or not, or you can live with a material which doesn't have these expensive element as alloying element. Okay, and still it serves your purpose. Okay, so in aluminium you have 1000 series aluminium. Okay, so these are basically pure aluminium, so nothing is added, commercially pure. Okay, so some impurities will always be there. So it will be only 99% aluminium content will be there. Now depending upon the processing it can be 99.9 or 99.99. okay, for different from different manufacturers you will get different purity. Okay, of course cost will be also will be dependent on that, on what kind of purity you want in a particular material. Okay, and since there is no alloying element here, if you want to kind of change the properties of this material, it can be only done with work hardening. Okay, so basically you can do a cold rolling or some working operation. Okay, to introduce large number of dislocation in the material, and thereby you can have work hardening in the material. Okay, so because there are no alloying elements, I can only do work hardening in this, or if you possible you can have grain size refinement. Okay, so grain size strengthening can also be there. The next one is 2000 series. The 2000 series is alloyed with copper. Okay, one of the important alloy initially people studied a lot to understand the aging phenomena in aluminium. Okay, and that is why you can see it can be precipitation hardened to very high strengths, and they were used as aerospace alloys for a very long time because they had high strength due to precipitation. Okay, and of course aluminium is a lightweight material, so preferred for aerospace application. Okay, but due to stress corrosion cracking problem, these precipitate act as sites where you can have stress concentration. Okay, and under corrosive environment, okay, you have stress corrosion cracking, and that is why they were later replaced now by 7000 series alloys. Okay, we will see what these 7000 series alloys are there. okay, but once copper alloys were very popular, aluminium copper alloys, okay. Then we have 3000 series. In this it is in this case it is alloyed with manganese, okay. Again manganese will go into solid solution, so these alloys can be work hardened. So next is 4000 series alloy, in which we add silicon into aluminium, okay, and these are some of the very important alloys because they give you very good casting ability. Okay, you can do casting very easily, and these are now used for making cylinder heads. Okay, you can understand they have a very complex shape with all these fins around them for better cooling. Okay, and they have to be casted, so you can understand that material has to flow in those complex shapes. Okay, for when you are doing the casting, so since it has a good flowability to get into those mold shapes, okay, that is why these kind of alloy aluminium silicon alloys are used for making this cylinder blocks nowadays. The next is 5000 series alloyed with magnesium, okay, it offers superb corrosion resistance. So wherever you need a good corrosion resistance, for example in marine application, okay, for example, ship is in saline water, so corrosion will be very fast in these kind of conditions. There, this aluminium magnesium alloy are very good, they have very good corrosion resistance, okay. And out of this 5083 alloy is one of the most popular alloy which is used in marine application, okay, and because it has the highest strength in non-heat treatable alloys, okay. So these are non-heat treatable, they do not show precipitation within the grain, okay. So either they are in the solid solution, or if any precipitate is also forming, they will form at the grain boundary, okay. So these are cannot be hardened using precipitation, okay. You cannot do aging of these alloys. So these are called non-heat treatable alloys, but the 5083 alloy has the highest strength in non-heat treatable class of materials in aluminium, okay. And they have a very good corrosion resistance, that is why they are used in marine applications. Then the 6000 series is there, alloyed with both magnesium and silicon, okay. So 6000 series alloy possess good machinability and weldability, okay, can be precipitation hardened, but not to high strength of 2000 or 7000 series, okay. So it cannot be as good as aluminium copper alloys or 7000 series alloys. 606 is one of the most commonly used general purpose aluminium alloys, okay. So if you see any general purpose aluminium wherever it is used, okay, most probably it will be 6061 alloy, okay, which contains both magnesium and silicon. Then comes the 7000 series, very important alloy, okay, because it is it comes under high strength category. These are called high strength aluminium alloys, okay, and these are nowadays used in large number of applications, especially aerospace application where you need high strength, and because you have aluminium as the base material, the density will also be low, the weight of the that particular component will be low, okay. So that is what is needed, and coupled with that you get a very high strength in these materials. For example, in case of some mobiles also, when they were advertising that these are made of aluminium and the cover is made of aluminium, these are all high strength aluminium alloys, okay, which usually comes under 7000 series. So it can be precipitation hardened, okay, to very high strength of any aluminium alloy, okay. For example, for 7608 alloy, okay, the hardness which you can achieve is 700 megapascal, the ultimate tensile strength, which is fairly good strength, it is close to any steel normally. So this kind of strength you can achieve in aluminium alloys, okay, by doing a very careful alloying with zinc and magnesium. Then comes the 8000 series alloyed with other elements which are not covered by other series. And in this class, one of the most important alloys are aluminium lithium alloys, and the importance of these alloys is that lithium is a very low density material, okay, the weight of the lithium per unit volume will be one of the very low in any structural material, okay. So if you are adding lithium in aluminum, the overall weight reduction is very good, okay. And in this, one of the very important alloy is 8090 aluminum alloy, aluminum lithium alloy, okay, again used in aerospace application because you want to reduce the weight of the body, whatever whether it is aeroplane or any other aerospace body, okay. So aluminum lithium alloys are very important, and in this 8090 is one of the most important alloy. So 8000 series you will see in large number of different alloying with different alloying elements, because it is given for kind of a general purpose alloys, and where alloying elements are can be quite different type of alloying elements can be there. Then we will come to material processing, just to give you an overall idea that how you get different type of materials. So we are not going in the processing like from ore to the main material which you get, okay. So we are not going into that processing right now, okay, because lot of processing is done in secondary processing also. For example, if you want to recycle steel or you want to recycle aluminum, okay, so that is already been extracted, refined, okay, and you have the material in useful composition, okay. So these are again remelted and you do casting. So lot of these industries are also there, and some industries are there which starts from the ore itself and then do the refining and later on do the other processing, okay. So right now we are not going into that part, okay. We will do starting from the casting, so that my material is already refined, or if you have a recycling already taken from a recycler and you know that you have segregated it into aluminum and steel scrap differently, okay. So the first process which we do is casting. So you basically melt the material in furnaces, and then you pour it into some big ingots, okay. So we are not kind of concentrating here on different type of castings, okay. Bulk material processing, that you do casting in ingots, okay. Then you will go to secondary some forming processes, okay. So these are either primary, you can divide into primary forming processes or secondary forming processes. The primary forming processes are usually done at high temperature, so that is why they are called hot forging, hot rolling or hot extrusion. The purpose of this particular step after casting is, if you remember when we were discussing solidification, okay, and what type of microstructure you get during solidification, we said that they contain dendrites, okay, and they some dendritic cast structure basically they have, okay. Then they also have lot of heterogeneity in composition. So heterogeneity in composition can be eliminated by doing a homogenization process, but to break this dendritic cast structure I have to do a processing where I impose very high deformations, okay. So that is why they are done at high temperature, where you can introduce more deformation in the material at one go, okay. So in this case you want to have very high deformation. So we either it can be done by forging, okay, or it can be done by rolling process, or it can be done by extrusion process. Then we go to the secondary forming processes, okay. So usually you do lot of rolling at this stage, so cold rolling is going to be there, okay. If you want strips of any sheet, then strip rolling will be there. If you want different shapes of material, for example you want a rail or you want a I-beam, okay, then rolling to give different shapes are there. So these are the final stages of processing. So you have casting, then primary forming process, then secondary forming process. this is a very broad classification here, okay. You can have much more refined classification also in between where different processes are done, okay. For example, after any forming process, maybe there can be annealing in between, okay, to kind of do a stress relieving or to do in case of precipitation hardening to dissolve the precipitate and make a solid solution and so on. And then you may have heat treatment later on also, okay. So casting, if you see, just we are concentrating here on the ingot casting because the casting itself is a big subject, okay. And you can see very big ingots are there, okay. It is already lying on a rail, okay. And you can understand that the what will be the dimension of this cast. So basically from a big ladle where tons of molten metal is there, it is poured into these kind of ingots where you get this shape of ingot, maybe rectangular shape or round shape depending upon what processing you want to do later on, okay. And then you do later forming operations. If this is kind of a batch process, you can see single ingot will be there and then it will be taken to for other processing, okay. Nowadays another very useful casting process is called continuous casting. So you can see that in this you have a continuous metal is coming in form of different shapes of ingots, okay. And it is a continuous process. So you put molten metal in some die, okay, and then the molten metal will flow down, okay, by vertical force or by due to gravity, and then it will be, when it starts solidifying, it will be kind of taken out and taken on some rails, okay, to which will be cut in different shapes later on, and then you do the secondary processing by doing rolling or extrusion or whatever end product you want from that. So this is a continuous process, this is a batch process, okay, whereas this is a continuous process. Then after casting we do rolling, okay, one of the process, it can be other processes also, okay. So hot rolling is done for heavy reduction, so basically to break your cast structure. Okay. Once you do that, in hot rolling, the problem is because the material will be hot, there will be lot of oxidation takes place. So you have scale on the surface. Okay. Also, when it cools down, it will have some distortion in the material. The surface finish will not be very nice. Okay. So we cannot do a hot process as the last process after which the materials go to the customer. But we can do it as intermediate process where we want very large reductions to break the cast structure, okay. So these are done in the initial processes, and the later on when the material is supposed to go out to customer, we do cold rolling, okay. So for producing sheet strips with high quality surface finish, in this case you get very good surface finish and closer dimensional tolerances, which is not possible with a hot rolling process, but initial processing is required at high temperature. We can also get I-beam, okay. So this is I-beam, and railroad rails are fabricated using grooved rolls. So either you can do a groove rolling, as you can see in this case we want to have a I-beam, okay. So you can see multiple rolls are there to make this particular shape, okay. Whereas in simple strip rolling, okay, you need only two rolls and the material will be taken through those rolls. It is like your sugar cane, you must have seen, if you want to take out sugar cane juice, you put sugar cane between two rolls, okay, and that squeezes it and you take out the squeezed sugar cane from the other side. Okay, so basically same process, two rolls are there and the material will go through these rolls. So initial material will have a higher thickness, after going through the roll, depending upon the separation between the roll, okay, the thickness will be reduced. and because you are putting so much strain, okay, maybe the strain will be enough to do to have some recrystallization in the material. So you will get very fine grain material after the reduction, okay. And these can be again processed using some groove rolls to get certain shapes, okay, depending upon your requirement. Forging is another very important process, okay. So it can be open die forging or closed die forging. So if you want a certain shape, then you can have a closed die forging, so the die itself will have that shape and then you are forging it, the material which will take the shape of the die. Or you can have an open die forging as being shown here right now, and you can see the size of the rolling, size of the forge machine and the size of the material which is being forged, okay. So if you have automatic crankshafts, piston connecting rods, railroad wheels are made by forging, okay. So by forging, because you are doing you are putting lot of compressive load on the material, okay, and already we have seen that the compressive stresses in the material are very good for their later on application, okay. First thing is you kind of remove the defects by forging. If there are any defects, you are kind of closing those defects, okay, and you are imposing some residual stresses, compressive residual stresses in the material, okay, and also the microstructure gets refined. You also introduce lot of dislocation density, okay. So overall you have a very dense material, okay, with minimal defects and very good microstructural properties, okay. And so this forging is a very important processes for any, to make any product where you need very high stresses will be there, okay. So for example, crankshaft or piston connecting rods, you can see continuously it is experiencing the fluctuating loads, okay. Railroad wheels, you can understand that so much load is there and they are rotating, so again continuous fatigue loading is there, okay. So all in all these condition you need a forged material, okay. So a cast material will just break under the load, okay. So by forging we are breaking the cast structure, refining the microstructure, introducing lot of strain hardening in the material, okay, to get a very high strength material. Extrusion is another very important process to make rods or tubes, okay. So if you put a mandrel here, this is called a mandrel, you can get a tube out of that, okay. There will be hollow section in the center and the material around it, okay. Or if you don't put the mandrel, you will get it in rod shape, okay. So in this case you have a die here, okay. It is a cross section is shown here and we are applying force from the other side, squeeze the material out from here, okay. A lot of in household we have this kind of technique to make certain what we call as namkeen, okay, to make using these kind of tools, okay. It is similar to that. So extrusion is basically you are putting force from the other side to squeeze the material out from the open end here in the die, okay, and the cross section is reduced during the process, okay. And also you are imposing lot of strain in the material, so it is getting work hardened. If temperature and strain are sufficient, you will have recrystallized microstructure and so on. So this is the axis symmetric process, okay. So to make a rod or to make a tube, it is a very nice process to make a tube or rod through the extrusion process. Another very important processing is what we call as powder metallurgy processes, okay. And usually in case of ceramics, you cannot do any other processing like casting, melting, casting and then other forming operations, okay. So in case of powder metallurgy alloys, in basically ceramics, that can be processed only using powder metallurgy processes, okay. Or if you have material which are hard to deform or we have high temperature, their melting point is very high, okay, then it will be very difficult to melt it and take into a ladle. A ladle will be of a low temperature material, okay. How you are going to store a liquid metal into these ladles, okay. So it is very difficult. So for high temperature materials, ceramics or hard to form materials, okay, we have a very good technique called powder metallurgy. So in this case, you process the material in solid state. So you have powders, you pour the powder whatever shape you want, final shape you want for the product, you make a die of that, put powder there and you then consolidate it, okay. So basically you have metal powders or ceramic powders, whichever powder you want, you do a mixing, you can add additives also, lubricants or binders, okay. Then you do a compaction, okay. So you make a compact of that, okay. And then we do sintering. So sintering means we have to heat this compacted powder to some high temperature below melting point to increase the diffusion process. So when you do the compact, the powder are only in kind of a mechanical contact, okay. They are not metallurgically bonded to each other, okay. So to have this metallurgical bond, we need to take it to high temperature so that diffusion is possible, and then the powder, each individual powder particle gets attached to the next one, okay, and the overall you get a product. Then depending upon the application, you can have secondary processes, either you can have machining or some other finishing operation, and then you have finished product, okay. So a very important technique for some type of materials where it is very difficult to melt them or form them. Now I am just taking here two examples, okay, that how now material are being celebrated. Celebrated in the sense, importance of a certain subject can be gauged from if that particular product is advertised like that, this is made of certain materials, okay. Then the you know that material has come to a certain stage, okay. For example, earlier if you want a good sound system, the advertisement will say that it has a Dolby sound system, or it has a stereo sound system, or it has a high fidelity sound system, okay. So you know that these are important things when it is advertised, okay. So for me, the importance of material comes when the materials or that specification comes in the advertisement of the product, okay. So I am just taking here two examples where the materials are celebrated because they are being advertised, that because of these material you are getting some special properties, okay, or some special product you are getting. For example, car bodies, now advanced high strength steels are being used in car bodies, okay. Recently you must have heard that in a lot of this crash test, none of the Indian cars could qualify, okay, almost all failed in those crash test to see that whether any impact on the car, whether the passenger will survive or not, okay. So now all these new cars which are coming, they are coming with a material which is called advanced high strength steels. So they have very high strength, okay. So by that you can also reduce the weight of the car body, and at the same time you have very high strength. So both, it is good for safety, okay, because you have a high strength material to take the impact load, and also it reduces weight of the car, okay. So you have improved safety, at the same time you have reduced weight, okay. So that is why this high advanced high strength steels are very important, and the strength is there because of the alloying elements, okay. Some alloying elements are added to get very high strength in these material. So basically the structure is made by advanced high strength steels. The car body, that is the plates which are covering the car, those are not very high strength. As I told you earlier also, those are interstitial free steels, IF steels, okay. So the only the structure, the main structure or the body of the car, okay, that is a high advanced high strength steels, and the remaining which is like panels which is covering the car, they are usually IF steels. Another product, smartphones. Okay, so one of the most important specification given in any smartphone is that what type of glass is used. So these are Gorilla glasses, all and they are trademark of certain company. Okay, so they are advertised like they have very high resistance to scratches, so you will not have scratches on the screen. Okay, and then they are also now coated with nano silver. Okay, so they don't have any smudging will be there, or little bit antibacterial properties also. Okay, or in for certain product or certain company also advertise that the body which phone has, it contain a high strength aluminium alloy. Okay, so again, as I told you, that some of the high strength aluminium alloys are used to make bodies of these smartphones. Okay, so these are actually advertised during the product launch, that these kind of materials are there. Okay, and that for me is a very good sign that, and also now you can also understand that the metallic materials are again coming into the fore. Okay, so earlier people started thinking that only the plastic will take over the whole thing, but now we see that the metallic materials are again coming becoming popular, and in this kind of very fancy product also you see that usage of metallic material is increasing. One of the most important reason for increased usage of metallic material is they are recyclable. Okay, whereas polymer or plastics, we are not able to recycle them. Okay, and for environment it is not good, whereas for any metallic materials it can be recycled. Okay, so once you discard them, the scrap can be again taken to some secondary processing units. Okay, there it will be again melted. Okay, and you can again start getting a new product out of that. Okay, so with that, our course is ended. This is the last lecture. Okay, just wanted to bring out the flavor of materials in different application and how they are processed, what are the designation of different alloys. Okay, so I hope the course will be of benefit to you. Okay, and it will satisfy your curiosity, and also it will help you to decide when you are making any product that which materials to use. Thank you.